Special contributions of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu is his revelation of the supreme position among all scriptures of Srimad-Bhagavatam. Perhaps those of you who have come in contact with bhakti, who have come in contact with Vaishnavism directly with the Gaudiya tradition among the followers of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu, this may not be something that you are aware of. But if you go to another sampradaya, another line, another tradition, even though they study all the Vedic literatures and they revere Vedanta Sutra, they revere the Bhagavad Gita, they revere the Puranas like Padma Purana and the Vishnu Purana, but they don't give any special position to Srimad Bhagavatam. Neither do they recognize Srimad Bhagavatam as Srila Vyasadeva's own commentary on the Brahma Sutra or Vedanta Sutra. This revelation is one of the special contributions of Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu. Srimad Bhagavatam Pramanamamalam Prema Mahato Puma Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu Matam Idam Tatrara Napara. Caitanya Mahaprabhu taught that Srimad Bhagavatam is the best evidence for understanding who is the Supreme Personality Godhead, that is Krishna of Vrindavan. And what is the best method of worshipping him? Following in the footsteps of the gopis of Vrindavan. And as Krishna is worshipable, the dust of his Vrindavan is as worshipable as Krishna himself. And the best evidence is Srimad Bhagavatam. And the goal of life is not to go to Vaikuntha. The goal of life is not to attain Krishna, or to attain Radha, or to attain Radha and Krishna. The goal is Prem. My Gurudev gave me this name, Prem Prayojan, so I don't forget. Prem Prayojan means the goal of life is only Prem, pure transcendental love. So, Krishna Bhakti Rasa Swarup Sri Bhagavat Sarva Veda Shastra Haite Parama Mahatva. Caitanya Mahaprabhu taught that Srimad-Bhagavatam is the rasa swarup, the embodiment of all transcendental mellows. And therefore, it is superior, it is foremost amongst all Vedic literatures. So what is the message of this Srimad-Bhagavatam? In the beginning, there, Sri Vyasadeva has given his invocation. Janmagasya yutahanvayat itaritaschate shvabhigyasvarat tane brahma vidaya adi kavi huyati yatsulaya tejo vari mridam yata vinimayo yata tisagong rasha dhamna swina sadanirasta kukam satam param dimahi. Dimahi. Dimahi means let us meditate. Dimahi comes from the dha dhatu, the verb root dha in Sanskrit, to hold. So meditation means to hold the beautiful form of Sri Krishna, to hold the lotus feet of Sri Krishna in your heart. That is meditation. So dhimahi, let us meditate. On what? Satyam param, the truth. Satyam, satyabratam, satyaparam, trisatyam, satyasyonim. When Krishna was in the womb of Devaki, then the demigods came and they were offering prayers. They said, you are Satyavrata, you are Satyaparam, you are Trisatyam, you are Satyasyonim, you are the origin of the truth, you are the origin of the Vedas. Nitanta Satye, and you are situated in your own Dham, which is also a manifestation of you, the eternal truth. Satyatmakam tam shanam prapanam. So we take shelter of you. So see, Krishna is Satya, and he is Satyam Param, the supreme, the highest truth, in his form as Shama Sundara in Vrindavan. So Dimahi means we meditate on him. So generally when we think about meditation, it's an individual activity. But here, it's in the plural. The first person plural. Not singular, not dual case, but plural. We meditate. How can meditation be a communal activity? Meditation is a communal activity when we engage in Nam Sankirtan. So when you want to understand the Vedic literature, there are different ling means symptoms that the authors, the compilers of Vedic literature, leave these signatures, these keys scattered around their works. And those who know them can identify them, put them together, and extract the essence. What is the ultimate purpose of that text? So the first one is called Upakraman Upasanha. That there's some common point between the opening statement of the scripture and the closing statement of the scripture. So the first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam tells us, Satyam Param Dhimahi, let us congregationally meditate upon the supreme truth. And the last verse of Srimad Bhagavatam says, Nama Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Papa Pranashanam Pranamo Dukkha Shamanas Tam Namami Hari Param. Chant the holy names and bow down. Maharaj was telling in the morning that the power of the holy name is revealed to those who are humble. So at the very beginning of Bhagavatam, and in the first verse and the last verse, there, the ling, the common point that we're looking at, is the devotee humbly taking shelter of Harinam Sankirtan, the chanting of the holy name, which brings about spontaneous meditation. Meditation is not imagination. Meditation means when the chitta becomes clean and the Supreme Lord reveals himself reflected on the pure heart, and you are seeing that and fixing your mind on it. That is meditation. Meditation is not a creative visualization that one day becomes real. But rather, it is a direct revelation, which is at first light and becomes more and more intense. You know, there are different degrees of meditation. Smaran, Dharan, Dhyan, Dhruvana, Smriti, Samadhi. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he said, the difference between Smaran and Samadhi is, in the stage of Smaran, there's a slight realization. In the stage of Samadhi, there's a full realization. But it's all realization. And there's no vikalpa, there's no imagination involved. Understand? So, Satyam Param Dhimahi. In the end of Srimad-Bhagavatam also, there, Sutta Goswami, he said, Kasmai teina vibhasito yam atulokyana pradipa pura tadrupena chanaradaya munaye krishnaya tadrupena yogindaya tadatmatata bhagavatrata rataya karunyatas tatshuddham vimalam vishokam amritam satyam param dhimahi. It's also the upasanha of Srimad Bhagavatam. Let us meditate on that supreme truth. Kasmai tena vibhasito, which was revealed by the Lord Himself in ancient times to Lord Brahma. Here the word is vibhasita. Vibhasit means revealed. In other words, though see Krishna himself imparted the Srimad Bhagavatam into the heart of Lord Brahma, Krishna himself did not compose Srimad Bhagavatam. He just revealed it because it's eternal. So even Krishna, though if you go on the parampara all the way back, it goes to Narada and Brahma and Krishna. Even Krishna himself did not compose Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam is eternal, independent, transcendental, self-manifested reality. Even Krishna has not created it. Only Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu began to reveal these glories of Srimad Bhagavatam. So, kasmai tena vibhasitoyam atulo, it is atul, it is incomparable. Jnana pradipa apura, and it is like a lamp of knowledge that illuminates the heart, which dispels all the darkness of maya. Tadrupena chanaradaya, and Brahma revealed it to Narada. Munaye Krishnaya Tadrupina. Narada revealed it to the Muni known as Krishna, means Krishna Dvaipayanvaita Vyas. He's also one Shaktivishavatar of Krishna, actually. And then Vyas, Yogindraya, he revealed it to the Yogendra, the king of the yogis, mystic yogis. Who is that? Shukadeva Goswami. Bhagavat Rataya Karunyatas. And then Shukadeva Goswami revealed it to Bhagavat Rata, that is Parikshit Maharaj. Then also he revealed it to Sutta Goswami. When Shukadeva Goswami was speaking to Parikshit Maharaj, Sutta Goswami was also there, he heard everything. So, and he is Ugra Sravar, he has a tenacious hearing capacity. He remembered everything. Then he spoke it to Shaunika Rishi and the sages of Naimisharanya. And then later Vyasadeva, he'd already manifested Bhagavatam, not in a complete form, and then he recompiled it again in the form that it is now. So, this is the history of Srimad Bhagavatam, how it comes to us. But there is some mystery in this. What is the mystery? Before each person, before Narada, it says tadrupena chanaradaya. Oh, in regard to Vyas, munaye krishne tadrupena. Oh, after Shukadev Goswami, yogindraya tadatmana, tadatmana. Each one, tadrup, 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 tadatma, means that in every stage and in every level in which the Srimad Bhagavatam was revealed in this world, the speaker every single time was Krishna. In other words, Tadrupena. Krishna revealed to Brahma. And then, in the form of Brahma, Krishna revealed to Narada. Tadrupena to Narada. Then when Narada began to speak to Vyas, Krishna himself manifested in the form of Narada and Krishna himself spoke it. And when Vyas spoke to Shukadeva Goswami and so on, when Shukadeva Goswami spoke, and this is called the Bhagavad Parampara. Because every time the Bhagavatam is spoken by a pure devotee, Krishna himself comes and he is the revealer of Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam ki! So there is no scripture equal to Srimad Bhagavatam. Such glories have not been mentioned anywhere in regard to any other Shastra. So there's throughout Srimad Bhagavatam, the glories of Bhakti, the glories of Harinam Sankirtan have been described. But each time we see that when a devotee receives mantra from their guru, or they engage in the chanting of the holy names and the angas of Bhakti, their realization comes. It is always preceded by Vaishnava Kripa. In the very beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam, Srila Vyasadeva humbly describes his own weakness. That he had compiled the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad Gita, Vedanta Sutra and other scriptures, but he felt dissatisfied. He wasn't satisfied. But then his Guru Pada, Padma Narada Rishi, came there and affectionately rebuked him and also blessed him. And then by the blessing of Narad, bhakti yogena manasi samyak pranihite vale pasya purusham punam mayam chatara pasyam. Vyasadeva went into trance, bhakti yogena manasi, the trance of bhakti yoga, samyak pranihite vale. Samyak means completely, pranihita means stopped. His mind, manasi, his mind completely stop. It was in a state of perfect stillness. And in that state, by the mercy of Krishna, coming through his Gurudev, Narada Rishi, he began to realize and see, like cinema, all the beautiful pastimes of Sri Krishna from his appearance in this world, his pastimes as a child, a baby in Gokul, as a child in Vrindavan, his lifting of Govardhan Hill, Rasalila, he's leaving and going to Mathura, and all the pastimes in Dwarka. He saw everything. And then Srila Vyasadeva, he manifested that in the form of a scripture for the benefit of all of us. And we see this theme again and again throughout Srimad Bhagavatam. Chitraketu Maharaj directly meets with the Supreme Lord by the mercy of Narada again. Prahlad Maharaj, what is his level of realization? He was like a mad person. He didn't know if it was day or night. He was sometimes laughing when he saw Krishna. And sometimes when Krishna disappeared, then he would weep. Sometimes his hair would stand on the end, he would feel the touch of Krishna's hands. Sometimes crying in separation. Then he would look in the distance and see a spurti of Krishna coming in the distance and saying, "Oh Prahlad, don't cry. I will never leave you." And then he would jump up and start dancing. Why? Oh, because he heard for thousands of years Srimad Bhagavatam from Narada Rishi. This is the effect of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam and engaging in Kirtan under the guidance of Guru. That the direct vision and experience of interaction with Sri Krishna becomes available to the soul. Narada himself told his life history to Vyas. He said, "In my previous life, I was the son of a maidservant, not a Brahmin, not Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, very low caste. And during the rainy season, my mother was serving some rishis. It was actually the four Kumaras. And they would sit together and speak to each other the pastimes of Krishna. And when they would eat something, then I would arrange their plates and clean up afterwards. And I was just a small boy, and I asked them, "Well, can I take some of your remnants?" And then I took their prasad remnants. And he said, and when I tasted their remnants, then the flow of the gunas, the guna pravaha, the flow of the gunas in my mind, which causes the states of wakefulness, dream and deep sleep, this flow just stopped. And I felt a very intense taste for listening to them, for hearing the holy names. And when the rainy season was over and they were leaving, they gave me mantra and instructed me how to chant and remember. And then I went to the forest, engaged in kirtan. And when I would remember mantra, Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna would come and place his lotus feet upon the lotus of my heart, and tears were streaming down my face. So Narad himself, in his previous life, experienced the power of sadhu sangha. That's the realization of Naam, the realization of Diksha Mantra, it came due to very humble service and honor to pure Vaishnavas. So, Maharaj mentioned this morning, Krishna Bhakti Janma Mul Hoi Sadhu Sangha, Prema Bhakti Janme Teno Puna Mukhya Anga. The root cause of the birth of love within our heart is the association of Vaishnavas. And even when one develops faith, and that faith matures, and the anartas clear, and one comes to nishta steadiness, and one comes to ruchi taste, and asakti deep attachment, and bhav, and then praying, even when that praying comes, still sadhu sangha is the main cause of our advancement. So one should not think, oh, I've been practicing a long time, I've had enough sadhu sangha. No, even when the devotee attends praying, then he's still hankering for the association of more advanced devotees. Just, if you even give up this life and you take birth as a gopi in Krishna's lila, if you don't associate with the nitya siddha, eternally perfect gopis in that lila, when Krishna plays his flute and calls everyone to Ras lila, then your husband and mother-in-law will lock the door and take a stick and stop you from going. So what to speak of the importance of sadhu sangha in this life, even when you go into Krishna's lila, it's most important to be in the guidance, in the anugatya, and serve under the guidance of those who are more advanced, especially the eternally liberated souls. I want to tell one history of a great Vaishnava. In South India, there was a kingdom called Travancore. And the king there, his name was Drdavrata Maharaj. So Drdavrata Maharaj, he was a very powerful and righteous dharmic king. Everyone in his kingdom was happy and satisfied because he chastised the criminals. The criminals lived in fear and the good people lived fearlessly. And every day the king used to go to the temple because he never considered that I am the king, I am the ruler, I am in charge of this place. He knew, I am only a caretaker. And the king is Lord Narayan, Ananta Padmanabha. Perhaps you have heard of that temple in South India, Ananta Padmanabha. So in those days the kings, when they would conquer other countries, they would collect so many treasures and they would offer the treasures to the deity of Ananta Padmanabha. And those treasures, they were kept in vaults beneath the temple. So it was only about a couple of years ago, the government of India, they could not restrain their curiosity and they wanted to see what was inside the vaults of the temple of Ananta Padmanabha. Did anyone see that in the news? Did someone see that in the news? So there were 6 vaults, and they opened them, and they found huge statues made of gold covered in diamonds. They found big chains of gold, meters long, so many emeralds and jewels and pearls and rubies. And they opened them one by one, and by the time they opened the 6th one, then they discovered, they estimated the value of the jewels of Anantapadmanabh was $1 trillion. So you know, Bill Gates thought that he was the richest man in the world, but actually, the richest man in the world is Anantapadmanabh. So don't think that it's an exaggeration when it said that the kings in those days, how they used to offer their treasures to the Lord and consider themselves to be His servant. So Drdavrata Maharaj, twice every day, he used to come before the deity and give pranams and then take out his book of administrative decisions and give a report to the Lord. Oh my Lord, today in your service I have reduced taxes by so many percent and I have passed judgment on this person and so on. And he would give the reports to the deity twice a day, very faithfully, close his book and go. So, how beautiful is the Vedic society when the king is really the king? Krishna himself, Supreme Lord, and everyone is his servant. But Drdavrata Maharaj, he had one problem, and that is he didn't have a son. So, he was doing so many sacrifices and he was praying to the Lord. And by the blessing of Lord Anantapadmanabh, after some time, when he was older, he conceived a son. And it was in the year 3075 BC. 3075 BC. So it was only 27 years after the beginning of Kali Yuga. So, now the king had a son and he gave him the name Kulashekar, the crest jewel, the pride of the dynasty. And when he was a boy, the prince was trained in Sanskrit, in the Vedangas, he was trained in politics and diplomacy and warfare and all the things that kings have to know. And so then when he became a young man and his father was getting old, then Drdavrata Maharaj installed his son as the king and Drdavrata Maharaj went to the forest. That's what kings used to do in those days. Can you imagine? That's devotion. That's faith in God. You're the king of a massive kingdom with so much wealth and luxury and you've lived that your whole life. But when you become old, then you realize, game over. Now you only have a certain amount of time left. And if you don't, your consciousness is not pure, if your heart is not fixed on the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, then it's back in the samsara again. Going around lifetime after lifetime, birth and death. Who can say whether you will be a king or not in the next life? So they know their priorities are in the right place, in the right order. So he knew the real purpose of my life is to attain the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. So he left everything and went to the forest. Now Kulashekar became king. So he was doing all of his duties and ruling very soundly, but he had some ahankar, some pride, some bodily identification. He was thinking, I am the king and I am ruling, I am doing everything, I am doing it well. I am successful. He thought like this. But what is this? We were discussing yesterday. Bhakti's sarvupadi vinira muktam tat praktena nirmalam. If we identify with this body, with our worldly position, thinking that we are kings or brahmanas or sannyasis or grihasthas or whatever, this is all upadi, this is all maya, this is only illusion. Our true identity, our actual soul remains covered. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to pray, Naham vibro na cha narapati na pivaisya na sudro Naham vani na chakrapati no banastoya tila Kintu pratyam nikala paramananda purnam ritabde Gopi Bhati Padakamalyo Das Dasana Dasana. Oh my Lord, I am not a Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya or Sudra. I am not a Sannyasi, Vanaprastha, Grihastha or Brahmachari. Then who are you? There is one endless ocean of shining, effulgent, divine nectar. And his name is Gopinath. And I am Das, Das, Anudas, the servant of the servant of the servant of that Krishna, the beloved of Gopis of Vrindavan. Only this identity. No other identity. No other tendency to try to assert our presence and control in the physical plane. Otherwise we cannot chant the holy names. Tanara, peace, unichena. So at this point in his life, Kulashekar Maharaj was not like that. He was thinking, ahankara vimudatma karta aham iti manyate. Bewildered by the influence of ego, I am the doer. But because he was following the tradition of his forefathers, that means he was doing his duties and every day coming before the Lord, reading out what he had done and saying, my Lord, karma, let's call karma prana, I offer the fruits of my activity to you. Gradually, he became purified. You know? In Bhagavad Gita it said, the purpose of all karma is what? Jnana. The purpose of doing your daily activities and your duties is by doing them without attachment, by offering the fruit of your activities to the Lord. Then tamagun, which makes us lazy and angry, goes away. Rajagun, which makes us lusty and proud, goes away. And one rises up to sattvagun. And when our consciousness is in sattvagun, sattvat sanjayate jnanam. From the mode of goodness comes Gyan, knowledge. Here knowledge means, not Divya Gyan, knowledge of the Divine Swarup of the Lord. Here Gyan means the power of discrimination between matter and spirit, between Chit and Achit, between Sat and Asat, the temporary and the eternal. This discrimination comes. So, but one should not stop there. Why? Sukha sangena badnati jnana sangena chanagaha. Krishna said to Arjuna, the mode of goodness, sattva guna, is also binding. Sukha sangena badnati, because then you feel satisfied. You feel content. The sufferings of the world fade away and your life is quite auspicious in sattva guna. So, then you can become complacent and not want to go further, to actually become nirgun, beyond the gunas. So jnana sangena chanaga, O sinless Arjuna, also by associating with jnana, sattvic jnana, knowledge, then you think, I'm wise. I'm wiser than these other people who are not wise like me. And then you feel relatively superior, so you don't want to go further. So the mode of goodness is also binding. In this regard, there's a very interesting history. Once, there was a yogi. His name was Jagishavya. So Jagishavya, he was a very expert in meditation. And you know, as you ekatva, one-pointedness of consciousness comes, you develop a power called samyam. Samyam means that you can concentrate your mind like a laser on different objects and you can understand perfectly those objects, what are their properties, and even acquire them for yourself. That is how yogis attain siddhis, you see. If you do samyam, concentration on the element of air, then your consciousness transforms, your chitta transforms and takes on those qualities, and thus you become like the air element. And then you can fly. So that's how the yoga city of flying comes. So each one of the cities, the yoga cities, they come from samyam, the concentration of the chitta on different elements, and then acquiring their characteristics. So one of the cities is to know your past lives. So if you do samyam, concentration on the samskaras, the impressions in your chitta, you can see your previous lives. So, because everything you experience is recorded. Your eyes are like video cameras recording everything. And in your chitta, in your subconscious mind, everything that you've ever done in all your millions and millions of lives is there. So if you develop that concentration introspection, you can find those impressions and you can see your last life, the one before that, the one before that. Depends on how powerful is your concentration, your dhyan, then you can realize this. So Jaigishava was famous because he could see all of his lives from the, how many is it? Maybe 10, I think. Kalpas. Right? So a kalpa is a day of Lord Brahma. Here in this context, it's a creation. The lives of Lord Brahma. So through so many lives of Lord Brahma, that's 311 trillion years. So many, many lives, many different Brahmas he could see. So how many times have you been born and how many times have you died? We can't even fathom it. So all of those lives he could see, and he was famous for that. So then there was one rishi, his name was Avatya Rishi. And Avatya Rishi, he was looking for Sadhu Sangha. And he thought, oh, this yogi, Jaigishabhya, he's got so much experience. Maybe, you know, someone can say, I've been practicing yoga for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. Okay. This Jaigishabhya has been practicing yoga for 311 trillion years times whatever, 10. You know? So let's find out from those who have experience, what is their experience? So Avatya Rishi, he was famous, he was a videha, that means he didn't have a gross body. So he used to just wander around in his subtle body, as many siddhas do. If you go to the Himalayas, there the yogis are doing meditation there, and when they get purified to a certain state, then they can see the siddhas are also doing their bhajan there, and they take instruction from them. You see Dhruva Maharaj, when he was standing on one leg and remembering his mantra, after 1 month he could see the siddhas. So this Avatya Rishi, he wanted to make an interview with Jaigishava. So from his, he manifested a gross body, and he came before him and bowed down. Oh Maharaj, please tell me, in all of your experience, can you tell me, how was your experience? What do you remember? He said, I remember millions and millions of lifetimes. And all I remember, sarvam dukam vivekina, everything was miserable. It was all suffering. Then the Rishi said, but for thousands and thousands of births, you have been situated in the mode of goodness. And because of this, you had siddhis, and you had the control over prakriti by your siddhis. And you must have felt contentment. You were powerful, more powerful than the demigods. So didn't you find some happiness, some sattvic happiness in your control over prakriti and your position like devatas? Jaigishava said, no. It was all suffering. Why? Because you may think if you had such powers and purity that you would be so, so happy. But he said that the happiness that people in this world call happiness, which is contact of the senses with the objects, is just suffering. But even my mystic powers, my self-control, my peace of mind, in comparison with mukti, liberation, that is also suffering compared to the ananda, the joy of being liberated. Why? Because it's still all Prakriti, even Sattva-gun. Even Sattva-gun is Prakriti. So we should understand very clearly that the true happiness cannot be found anywhere from any position within Triguna of this material world. The true happiness of the soul lies in only giving happiness to the Supreme Soul, to our soul, Sri Krishna. So, we're discussing about Kulashekar Maharaj by doing karma arpana, offering the fruit of his work to the Lord. He came to Sattva Gun, and when that came, his gyan, his vivek, his discrimination was aroused. And by that discrimination, he looked at the world and he thought, it's all suffering. I must transcend. Though he was a king, he was an emperor, though he was sitting on the throne, his feeling when he was sitting on the throne was the same as the feeling of a criminal standing on the gallows when they put the noose around his neck. That's how he saw his power, position and his kingdom. So he was praying, "Oh my Lord, Ananta Padmanabha, please give me your shelter, give me your service." So the Lord heard his prayers and sent him a guru. In Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu, Srila Rupa Goswami has said, "Krishna tad bhakta karunya mat lobaika hitavaha." There is only one cause for the attainment of greed. The eligibility to practice Raganuga Bhakti, spontaneous devotional service, is greed. And what is the cause of loba, greed? Only one cause. Krishna tad bhakta karunya matalo baika heitavaha. The only cause is the mercy of Krishna and his devotees. There's no other way. We can enter into Raganuga Bhakti. We can even experience what that greed is like without blessings. Now the reason Srila Rupa Goswami said that the blessings of the pure devotees is the only cause for Raganuga Bhakti is because he was contrasting with Vaidhi Bhakti. There's a chance that sometimes a person enters into Vaidhi Bhakti through the path of Krishna Karmapana. In other words, they're doing their duties in Varnashram Dharma and they offer the fruit of that work to Krishna, and by this they gradually transition into the inclinations for Vaidhi Bhakti. Sometimes happens. So this happened with Kulashekar Maharaj, and the Supreme Lord sent him Guru. Who was this Guru? He was not an ordinary sage or rishi, but it was Lord Narayan's personal intimate associate, Visvaksen himself, came to him in the form of Guru and gave him panca-samskara, five samskaras. There are five rituals that give five types of impressions. And this is what comprises diksha, really initiation. So it is said in Srila Bhagavata Devotion in Pramaya Ratnavali, there he has written, "Tapa pundram tata nama mantro yagas chapanchama anihi pancha sanskara paramaikanti hetavaha." These five samskaras are the cause, paramaikanti hetava, means the cause of supreme concentration. So when the disciple comes to the guru and his mind is everywhere, so many thoughts going around, like a smoothie in a Vitamix, you know. No, when you're making a smoothie and you put it in and turn it on, spinning around. So when the disciple first comes to guru, his mind is like that and his thoughts are going around. How to make it still? How will the mind become focused? Just like in Bhagavad Gita, Sri Krishna says to Arjuna, "Kachit etat shrutam partha tvayeka grena chetasa kachit ajnana sammoha pranasta stage anantananjaya." O Partha, O Dhananjaya, have you listened to this Bhagavad Gita with tvayeka grena chetasa, ekagrata chitta, one-pointed attention? Kachit ajnana sammoha, and has the bewilderment of ignorance being pranastaste dhananjaya, being destroyed. The implication is that when we listen to Bhagavad Gita, when we listen to Srimad-Bhagavatam, when we listen to Harikatha with ekagrata citta, with a peaceful mind, with a still mind, then all illusion is dispelled. Why? Because the anubhav, realization, appears. So when the disciple comes to the guru knows the process, the technique, how to take that disciple's mind, which is like a blender, and slow it down and help them to have paramaikanti hitavaha, fixity of mind, nishta, ekagrata citta. So that process is called diksha, and it begins first tapa. Tapa, the general meaning is that the disciple receives, is branded with the signs of Vishnu in the Sri Sampradaya. That's what they do. And they take a brand in the fire, and they heat it up, and they go and psh, and then you have a chakra and a corns and blah, like that. So I think it's a good test for those who are sincere. That's it. Oh, who wants to take Harinam? Everyone rushes forward. Okay, who wants initiation? I've got the brands right here. Oh, where did they go? So, but in our Bodhya Sampradaya, we don't brand ourselves with the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Mahavadanya, yeah, supremely merciful. So you can just write the name of the Lord or the symbols of the Lord on your body with cooling sandalwood paste. So how merciful is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? But tapa means burning. It means first the disciple should be in a state of anutap. That is repentance. That their heart is burning, that I wasted my life. I've been doing so many foolish things. So first tapa, then pundra. Then the guru gives tilak to the disciple, urdhva. Urdhva means two lines going up. When we repent for our foolish, animalistic, base, gross activities in the mundane plane, then we can turn our attention up. So the real meaning of putting on tilak is to turn your attention up beyond this world. Then naam, guru changes your name from whatever, Wolfgang Schmidt, or whatever your name is, and gives you a spiritual name, Krishna Das, servant of Krishna, and also gives naam, the holy name. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Then the next samskar is the giving of mantra, the diksha mantra, which is not chanted out loud, which establishes our sambandha, our relationship with our Ishtadev, the form of the Lord with whom we are eternally related. And then last, yaga means the guru teaches the disciple how to do archana, how to worship the deity. Because when you serve the deity, then you have to rise early in the morning, take a bath, put on tilak, then wake up the deities and clean their teeth and offer them something to drink and then offer arti. And so the daily schedule of serving the deity is regulated, so you become regulated. And so by following the path of archan, your life becomes regulated and clean, and gradually all the kadarya shio, that means unvirtuous activities, non-meritorious activities, kadarya shio goes away, and vikshipta citta, the restlessness of the mind goes away. And then, when our consciousness is steady, we can take advantage of the experience of hearing and chanting. This is why Vyasadeva says, Tachrinvan supatam vichatam sajo riddhyavarudayatta kritivi susrusubistachanat. As soon as a pious person just desires to hear Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna comes into their heart and the door closes behind him and he cannot leave. He's trapped. So Krishna becomes captured in your heart. In the heart of that person who just desires to hear Srimad Bhagavatam, it's so powerful. But there's a small print, there's a condition, and that is kriti b, that you have to be kriti, an accomplished, a refined person, one who's being prepared. So that prep school, that preparation, is actually the process of diksha. So when we come to our Gurudev and he takes us through these five samskaras, then we become kriti, refined, and prepared and accomplished. And then in that state, if such a person, what to speak of hearing Srimad-Bhagavatam, just desires to hear Srimad-Bhagavatam, Krishna is captured in their heart immediately. The implication is, if you're not prepared and you listen to Srimad-Bhagavatam, Krishna will also be captured in your heart, but it won't be immediately, it will take a few days. Srimad-Bhagavatam is so powerful. So, Visvaksen himself became the Diksha Guru of Kulashekar Maharaj. And following his Guru's instructions, he became completely fixed. His mind was fixed on the lotus feet of the Lord. And his Brahmin priests used to come every day, and he used to hear Harikatha, Srimad-Bhagavatam. Especially he liked to hear Ramayana. He was very attached to hearing the Ramayana. And when they would hear the Ramayana, for him, now he had ekagrata citta. Listening was no longer a theoretical thing. It was no longer something like, you know, sometimes a person thinks, I'm going to go to a lecture, and in that lecture I'll note everything down and can collect some bits of information like that might be useful later in my life. So, that's not sravanam. Sravanam means when you hear the pastime, you see it in your heart. And all the action, all the drama, all the romance, all the emotions of the persons in that lila, you feel them and you're involved in that. It's not a pastime that took place 5,000 years ago. It's happening right now because it's an eternal reality. That is sravanam. That is hearing. So when Kulashekar Maharaj, he was listening to Ramayana and he heard the story how Lord Ram was born, then he was feeling. It was as if he were there in the palace of Dasaratha Maharaj. When he heard how Lord Ram went to the Swayamvara, the husband the bridegroom selection ceremony of Sita Devi, and Lord Ram, you know, there was a test, who can lift up the bow of Lord Shiva? Because Sita Devi, when she was a little girl, she was dusting. And she thought, let me dust underneath the bow, and she picked it up with one hand and she dusted underneath, like that. But the bow was so heavy, even powerful warriors couldn't lift it. So then her father was thinking, I can't marry my daughter to a husband who's weaker than she is. Right? Because there was no feminism in those days. So he thought, at least there should be a test that any warrior, they'll have to come, they'll have to lift this bow first, and after that then they marry my daughter. So they had this bridegroom selection ceremony, and so many heroes came, and they took it in turns. But they couldn't touch it. But then what happened? Earlier, Sita had been walking in the forest, and there she saw a beautiful young man. And when two eyes met with two eyes, each of them stole each other's heart. They couldn't believe it. And Lord Ram, he said to Lakshman, what's happening to me? I am in the dynasty of Dasarath Maharaj, in the Raghu dynasty. No king in our dynasty has ever gone against Dharma. But now I've been attracted to a woman to whom I am not married. Lakshman said, oh, my lord, be patient. There must be some mystery behind this. The mystery is that person whom he saw was his eternal consort, Sita Devi. So then after that, Sita was thinking of this young prince. And she saw all the other princes coming, trying to lift the bow. And then imagine her joy when she saw that very prince who had stolen her heart at the first glance, came there and heroically lifted the bow and bent the bow and strung the bow and broke the bow also. Then she was in great bliss. Oh, my hero. And she came with tears in her eyes, tears streaming from her eyes and hands trembling. Because she has to give him the garland by which he's selected as a husband. But her arms were trembling so much that she couldn't, because he's tall and he's also wearing a crown. Yeah, like that, so she couldn't reach up. So some of her sakis were with her, they were holding her arms to try to help her lift her arms. But they couldn't reach up. So the saki said to Lord Ram, just bow down a little bit. You know? Lord Ram said, no king of the Raghu dynasty ever bowed down to anyone. So then Lakshman was very intelligent. He fell down at the feet of his brother. So when someone you love gives pranam to you, then you bend down and you love him, you pick them up to embrace them. So by this trick, Lord Ram, he reached down to his brother, and then the Sakis of Sita moved her arms and put the garland over his crown. So when Kulashekar Maharaj was hearing these pastimes, he was there in the palace of Dasarath Maharaj. His hairs were standing on end, he was trembling in ecstasy. The union of Sita Ram. This is sravanam. This is what it means to hear. So, just like in Vrindavan also, there, very often there's a Bhagavad Saptaha, and we hear the pastimes of Krishna. But it's not just only sitting and hearing, but everyone becomes involved. When they get through 9 cantos and they come to the 10th canto, and the katar is there that Krishna is born, then all the people come bringing toys for the baby. Right? If a baby is born, then you have to come and bring presents, and they bring toys, and they offer, they have a balagopal on the swing, and everyone sings, Jio Shamalala, 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 Chili Teri Pagadi Rangakala. Everyone comes to give blessings to the baby. Jio Shamalala, now you have a long life. And then when they get to, when Krishna told Nanda Maharaj, don't do a yagya for Indra, you should offer everything to Giriraj Govardhan. Then at the end of the katha that day, then everyone comes carrying so many preparations of bhoga on their head, and they join in with Nanda Maharaj and all the bridge vases in doing the Anukut Mahotsav, offering the prasad to, offering bhoga to Giriraj. And then when they come to the Rasalila, where Radha and Krishna finally meet together for the first time in the forest, then they have aarti to Radha, Jai Jai Radha Krishna Juga Vilayan, Arati Kolayana Vidani Sakima. Everyone is involved. Why? This is not history. This is Nitya Lila. It's happening right now. This is really Shravana. So Kulashekar Maharaj, he was relishing, he was realizing in this way daily, hearing Ramayana. So then one day, one of the pandits in the court was reading the pastimes of Lord Ram, and he read, on this side, 14,000 demons stand with sinful hearts and violent hands. And on this side, Lord Ram, by virtue known, how can our hero stand and fight alone? So when the king heard this, he was so worried. He thought, oh, Lakshmani is with my mother Sita protecting her. And now my Lord Ram is in the forest. He's surrounded by 14,000 cannibalistic Rakshasa demons. They want to kill him. We have to assist him at once. Mobilize the troops. He called his generals, call the cavalry, mobilize the infantry, bring the elephants and the cannons. We're going to war! And the king put on his armor and his weapons, and he got on his horse, and he set out from the city with his infantry. Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. He was completely absorbed. This is called smarana. After shravanam and kirtanam, then comes smarana. And he set off to assist Lord Ram. So he was marching off with the armies, and the ministers were thinking, what can we do? This is a disaster. So then one of the ministers came up with an idea. listen, let's just get one division of the cavalry who are really fast, and we'll send them by another route. And they'll go round in a big circle and meet the king with the marching armies coming in the opposite direction. And then we'll read some of the Ramayana to him after Lord Rama's killed those Rakshasas and he's safe and everything's okay. So then the cavalry set off. And they marched off in a big, galloped away in a big circle, and the king was coming with his infantry, and he saw his own soldiers galloping the other way to meet him. And they got down from their horses. Your Majesty, we have very good news for you. What is that? We have just returned from the battlefield. And then they read one verse of Ramayana. All the foes lie slain upon the ground. The sages and rishis in the forest have been protected. And Sita Devi looked at the face of her beloved Ram and fell into his arms. Oh, my hero. When the king heard this, then he felt inexpressible joy. So then he realized, oh, so no need for our help now. And then he told his men, okay, everyone, return back to the city. So then very happily he went back to the city to continue hearing Harikatha. So then, after that, the pandit who used to read to him every day, he thought, I have to be really careful. When I'm reading this, when I get to the happy parts of the Ramayana, I'll expand upon that and explain it more and we'll go into more detail. And when I get to the sad parts, then I'll just skip over that really quick and go to another happy part. Otherwise, it will make another problem for the king. So in this way, Harikatha was going on every day and the king was very happy. But it came to one situation where that pandit, he had to go on business to another state. So before he left, he told his son, listen, my dear boy, I can't read for the king today, so here's the Ramayana, you'll have to read for him. And then he went off on his business. But he forgot to tell the boy, oh, and by the way, you have to skip over the sad parts. So then after a few days, the young Brahmin pandit, he was in the court and the king was there with his ministers and other devotees, and he began to read. And he got to the part where Ravan came and stole away Sita Devi. And he just read it. He didn't know any better. So he read that part. Then the king's face became red. He became ferocious. We must go and invade Lanka at once. We'll kill Ravan and his whole family and everyone in the dynasty. We'll burn the place to the ground. Generals, mobilize the troops. Mobilize the cavalry. We're going to war. And he got up, he put on his armor, and he got on his horse and began to gallop away with all the soldiers. Sri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Sri Ram, Jai Ram,
Jai Jai Ram. Sri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Sri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram.
So as you know, Sri Lanka is across the ocean. So gradually the armies made their way to the shore of the ocean. And the ministers were like, what will we do now? And the king, he got down from his horse and he was just running, and the beach was very shallow. Have you ever been on one of those beaches where the water is shallow and it slowly, 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 slowly gets deeper and deeper as it goes out? So the king with his sword, he went running into the ocean, and he was running, he was up to his knees in the water, he was running up to his waist, and then he was up to his neck, and he's got his armor on, he was about to drown. So then his deity, he was worshipping the deity of Lord Ram back in his palace. The deity could see everything. And by divine vision, he thought, oh, I have to do something. So then his deity of Lord Ram and Sita appeared there in the sky before him. And Lord Ram was smiling, and Sita Devi was holding the arm of Lord Ram, and they were happily together. Lord Ram said, oh, my dear devotee, don't be disturbed. The battle is over and we are victorious. And once again, I've been united with my Janakasutra. And just as I carry the souls over the ocean of material existence to the spiritual world, Vaikuntha, so I will bring you back to the shore. And Lord Ram reached down and picked up the king from the water and carried him back to the shore. And with procession, he followed him all the way back to the city, and then the spurti of Lord Ram and Sita disappeared. So now the king, he was in such viraha, vipralamba, because what happens? Na bina vipralambe na sambhoga pushti mashnute. The purpose of meeting with the Lord, the purpose of separation is to increase the joy of meeting. But when there's meeting and then separation occurs, then the separation increases also. So now his separation from Lord Rama and Sita was very, very intense. He could not live. He again and again he said, I will give up my kingdom, I'll run away from here. I'll go to Srirangam and stay there with Ranganath and in the company of the devotees there. So his ministers were thinking, we'll lose the king, how can we keep him here? So then they came up with a plan. Let's get some Vaishnavas who are on pilgrimage and invite them and bring them to the palace. Because whenever Vaishnavas come, then a great Vaishnava is very delighted to meet other Vaishnavas and wants to serve them. So the king was thinking, I'm going to leave and go to Srirangam, but if we keep bringing Vaishnavas here, then it's all. Some great personalities have come, he'll bow down to them, he'll serve them, he'll take care of them, and it will delay him, it will keep him here. So they brought a group of Vaishnavas and the king was happily serving them. And then after some time the king said, I'm going to leave everything and go to Srirangam. So then they brought another group of Vaishnavas. And they kept doing that again and again to delay the king. So then after some time, the ministers thought, oh, this is like out of the frying pan and into the fire. Because now, look what happened to the palace. It's just, they're just Vaishnavas everywhere. I don't know if you've ever had Vaishnavas stay in your house. No, it's like, you know, dotis are hanging everywhere. So the palace was now just completely overrun with Vaishnavas everywhere. And the king was serving them all the time. And the ministers were becoming quite disturbed. They said, what is this king thinking? He boldly declares that serving one Vaishnava only one time is superior to serving the Supreme Lord Himself for 60,000 years. And really, this is the conclusion of Shastra. Krishna said, Mad bhakta puja vyadika. The service of my devotee is superior to service to me. Pratamantu gurum pujam tatastaiva mamachanam. Silim abaknoti. Shastra says that, Krishna himself has said, first serve your guru and afterwards serve me. If you serve me first, there's a doubt whether or not you'll become perfect. But if you serve your Gurudev first, if you serve Vaishnavas first, then there's no doubt at all. You must become siddha, perfect. Yeme bhaktas jana prata, name bhaktas tate jana. Krishna said, one who says that he is my devotee, I don't accept him. But one who says he's the devotee of my devotee, then I accept him. Durapa alpata pasa, seva vaikuntha vatmasu, yatropagiyate nityam deva deva janadana. In Srimad-Bhagavatam, there it is said that the association of such saints is extremely, extremely rare. Those whose sukriti is meager, they cannot attain the association of those persons who are traversing the path to the spiritual world. Akshnofalam tvatrisha darshanam hi vapu tanu phalam tvatrisha gata sangaha jivafalam tvatrisha kirtanam hi sudulava bhagavata hi loke. Sri Caitanya Mahaprabhu, he said to Ram and the Rai, seeing you is the perfection of having eyes. Because in this world we see so many things, but what's the fall, what's the fruit of seeing those things? If you look at a materialistic person, you look at a materialistic place, only seeing that is entangling you more and more in the confines of birth and death. But when we see a Vaishnava, that's the fruit of having eyes, because simply seeing a Vaishnava cuts our bondage completely, and there's no obstacle between us and the spiritual world. So, akshnofalam tvadrusha darshanam hi. The fruit of having eyes is to see a Vaishnava. The fruit of having a body is to engage in the direct service to the Vaishnava, cooking, massaging, serving in all ways. The fruit of having a tongue is to glorify the Vaishnavas. Sudulabha bhagavata hi loke. But such great persons, they are very, very rare in this world. So the king appreciated this principle and was just serving Vaishnavas more and more and more. He couldn't stop serving more and more Vaishnavas. So after some time, the ministers became upset and they thought, we've got to get rid of this Vaishnava population in the temple. It's overcrowded. What can we do? So they came up with a plan. They came to the king and said, oh Maharaj, you gave a very beautiful jeweled necklace to your deity of Lord Ram, but it appears that it's been stolen. The king said, who has done it? They said, we have made some research and it seems that it was these Vaishnavas. Then the king became furious. He said, oh, it was the Vaishnavas, you say. I don't believe you. What to speak of committing such an act? Even the thought could never enter into their pure minds. At once, bring me a pot with a cobra inside, a deadly snake, and I will prove by the trial of ordeal. So then a servant brought a big pot with a poisonous snake inside. He said, I'll put my hand in this pot, and if the Vaishnavas never any time allow any sinful thoughts to come into their mind, then the snake will not bite me. And if they've stolen this necklace, then he'll bite me at once. So then the king, looking in the eyes of those ministers, he just thrust his hand inside the pot with the snake and waited. So there was a pin drop silence. And then the king took his hand out of the pot. So then all the ministers were afraid. They were trembling. And they fell down at the feet of the king. Please forgive us, please forgive us. For our intrigue. The Vaishnavas are innocent. So then the king, he immediately forgave them. Vaishnavas, they don't keep a grudge. They have no spirit of revenge. At once, forgotten. Don't do it again. Very, very liberal. But he decided, but I cannot stay in this place where Vaishnavas are being offended. I will leave at once and go to Shirana. So then, Kulashekar Maharaj, he abandoned everything. And only he had a young daughter of marriageable age. And he took her with him to Shirana. So one might think, oh well, he left everything but he's still attached to his daughter. But that's not true. Because he took her to Shirana and he just wanted to arrange her marriage to Ranganas. So he got his daughter married to the deity, then he considered, now all my responsibilities, now the responsibilities have been met, they are over, and he absorbed himself in bhajan for a few years, and at the age of 67, he transcended this world completely and went to the eternal abode. So that Kulashekar Maharaj, he has composed very beautiful prayers. In his Mukunda Mala Stotra, Krishna Tvadiyata Padapanjana Panjanantam Adyaiva Medishastu Manasurajahansa Prana Prayana Samaye Kapabata Pitte Kantavarodina Vido Smaranam Kutaste. O my Lord Shri Krishna, may the swan of my mind become entangled in the lotus of your feet today, right now. You know, it's a very beautiful imagery. If there are beautiful lotus flowers growing in a lake and a swan comes, the swans love to dive into where the lotuses are and play around with them. So the swan's neck is very long and the lotus stems are very long. And after the swan has been playing, they're all wrapped around his neck and he's just in bliss. But he can't get out. So in this way he said, may the swan of my mind become completely entangled in your lotus feet. That means that it can't get out. And may that happen today. Because some people think, now I'll just do this and that, and when the time of death comes, then I'll remember Krishna. But that's not so easy. That's not so easy, because at the last moment of your life, all the things that you are doing flash before your eyes. And so, unless you are in kirtan every day, serving the deities every day, hearing Harikatha every day, then all material activities will fill your mind. But if daily we're absorbed in hearing, chanting and remembering, then what will happen? Oh, so many kirtans, so many festivals, so many harikatas will flood into the mind. So he said, at the time of death, how will I remember you? When the temperature suddenly goes very high and suddenly goes very low, and there's a complete disturbance of the dhatus, the bodily humors, kapha, pitta and vata. And then the throat becomes full of phlegm and I cannot chant the holy name. So my Lord, bless me that I can remember you right now. To become absorbed right now. And Kulashekar Maharaj, he prayed, Mat janmana palamidam madukaita vahari Mat prataniya madanugara esha eva Tvat britya britya parichayata britya 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 brityasya britya itimam smaralo ganata. Oh my Lord, the fruit of my life, my only desire that I am praying for, and the only thing that I consider to be your mercy, is that when you remember me, you think of me only as the servant of the servant of the servant of the menial servant of the assistant of the servant of the assistant of the menial servant of your servant. Britya britya parijarika britya britya brityasya britya. So this is a very selfless love, because if you serve Krishna directly, he'll see you and you'll experience his smile, his glance and some reciprocation directly. But the service which is done at a distance to the servant of the servant of the servant, then of course in his heart he will see. But that's just between you and Krishna. There's no question of the prestige and honor and all of these things. So the devotee, he considers himself to be most fortunate if he can have even the most distant connection with the dust of the lotus feet of the Lord. So in this way, the conclusion of the Vaishnav Shastra is holy name is everything. But in order to avail ourselves of the power and realization present in the name, Vaishnav Seva comes first. The Vaishnav Seva comes first. It is called, in Ayurvedic medicine, there's something called Anupan. Anupan means that there's a medicine and this medicine will cure you. However, before you take this medicine, you should drink some milk. So what you have to take before the medicine, which facilitates the potency, your experience of the potency of the medicine, is called an anupan. So in this way, Vaishnav Seva is the anupan. And then when we chant the holy name, which is the medicine, and that will destroy the disease of material existence and bless us with Krishna Prem. Gaur Premanande!
Radhe Shyam, Radhe Shyam, Radhe Shyam, Radhe Shyam. Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare
Hare Krishna.
Bhakti Festival, Bhakti-Festival, 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 Bhakti-Festival,